credit for this scary short story goes to Reddit author and writer MPZ1968. Please subscribe and click the notification bell to get notified whenever a new scary short story is posted. Hello, my horror family. It's about that time for another amazing scary story. If you don't mind, leave a comment for the author in the description below. You are listening to I Wanna Be a Tree by MPZ1968. Narrated by Matthew. I'm sure all of you, well, the adults anyway, have received that letter in the mail. You know the one I'm talking about. The one where it says, "You won blah 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 from blah blah blah, just call this number to claim your prize." Right? I mean, we all have, and 99.9% of the time, it's all bullshit. Companies trying to get you to send money, or buy something first. Well, I received such a letter, about 3 months ago. But, this one was different. I walked out to the mailbox to check the mail, obviously, and found just one piece of mail. Which was odd. There are always ad flyers, bills, and junk mail in there. But not that day. Anyway, it was a plain white envelope with my name and address typed in the center of the envelope. In the upper left-hand corner, where it states who the sender is, were the handwritten words, "The Law Offices of." Two Jewish names, with an address, and a phone number underneath. No postage stamp, and no stamp from the post office it came from, nothing. It was like someone just stuck it in my mailbox. I stood there, on the side of the road, staring at it. Am I being sued by someone? Am I being asked to join a class action suit against some pharmaceutical company? I wondered. I walked back into the house, still staring at it. Curiosity got the better of me, so I opened it. Inside was a white piece of paper, folded in threes. I pulled out the paper, unfolded it, and read what it said. "Dear Mr. Thompson, you have been named as the sole beneficiary in the last will of Mrs. Agnes Miller. Please call the following phone number to claim your inheritance." With a handwritten signature, that I couldn't read, at the bottom. Yeah. Right, I thought to myself, I don't know any Agnes Miller, and tossed the papers on the dining room table, and continued with my day. They sat there all night. The next morning, I awoke, walked to the kitchen, turned on the coffee pot, and sat at the dining room table, until it beeped. I then got up, made my coffee, and sat back down at the table, drinking my coffee, and staring at the papers. I then began to think about my life, my humdrum, boring life. Doing the same thing, day after day. In the same house, at the same job, driving the same car, eating the same food. Anyway, you get the point. What the hell? Maybe something exciting will happen, I thought, as I grabbed the papers, pulled out my phone, and called the number. It rang several times before a very pleasant female voice answered the phone. "The law offices of whoever. How may I help you?" she said. "Yeah. I got this letter in the mail saying that I was named as the beneficiary in someone's will, that I don't even know," I replied. "Your full name please, sir?" she asked. "Why?" "So you can add me to some stupid mailing list and start sending me dumb shit in the mail." "What kind of scam are you running here?" I responded, slightly aggressive. "Sir, we are a law firm, not a telemarketer." "We don't do that, sir," she said, reassuringly. I was stunned for a minute. "Your name, sir?" she asked, politely, with a hint of sarcasm. I told her my name. "Oh. Mr. Thompson, we've been waiting for your call, please hold," she said happily. I then heard the irritating sound of elevator music on the line. A couple of minutes later, an older gentleman picked up the phone. "Hello, Mr. Thompson. I'm David, something Jewish. I'm terrible at remembering names. Anyway, I am the executor of the Miller estate. How are you doing today?" he said. I ignored the question. "Well, Mr. Thompson, I'm about to make you a very wealthy man," he said. "Yeah. Right. How?" I asked. "I don't want to discuss this over the phone. I'm sending a car to pick you up. You're a few states away. So, it should be there sometime tonight. Be ready when it gets there," and then he hung up on me. Now, being the cynical person that I am, I just blew it off, as a bad joke, and threw the papers in the trash. Anyway, I was off work that day. So, I just relaxed around the house like I always do on my day off. I was watching some stupid rerun on TV, about 9 o'clock that night, when there was a knock on the door. I don't have any friends. I didn't order a pizza. Who the hell could that be? I thought. As I got up to answer the door, I just so happened to look at those papers sitting in the little trash can by my chair. No fucking way. It can't be, I said aloud, as I walked to the door and opened it. Standing there was this incredibly beautiful woman, with long, wavy blonde hair, wearing a chauffeur's outfit. Mr. Thompson. Hi. I'm Stacy, she said, extending her hand. I'm here to pick you up. Are you ready? I shook her hand. Not really. I thought it was a joke, I said, confused. This is no joke, sir, she replied. I have to work in the morning, I said, trying to get her to go away. I was instructed to inform you, sir, that your employer has agreed to issue you an extended leave of absence, she said. How? I asked. I just drive the car, sir, she replied, are you ready? I then turned and looked at the same four walls that I'd been staring at for the last 15 years. Yep. Ready as I'll ever be, I said. Very good, sir. Right this way, she said, smiling. I walked out of the door, shutting it behind me, and looked out into the street. There, I saw the longest, the blackest, and the coolest looking limousine that I've ever seen in my life. Stacy walked to the back passenger door, opened it, and motioned for me to get in. I did, and she shut the door. Seconds later, Stacy's voice came through the intercom, "We've got a long drive ahead of us, sir. Try and get some rest," she said. The only reason I can remember her name is that she was so pretty, and I always remember pretty girls' names. Anyway, maybe this will help you rest, sir, Stacy said through the intercom once again, as the soothing sounds of raindrops came through the speakers. Normally, mood music irritates the hell out of me. But, this time, it was rather relaxing. I laid my head back against the backseat and listened to the raindrops. I must have fallen asleep, because the next thing I knew, I heard Stacy's voice announcing that we had arrived at our destination. Now, I am in no way, shape, or form a morning person. I slowly came to, as seconds later, Stacy opened the back door, and I crawled out of the limousine, shielding my eyes from the sunlight. Where are we? I mumbled. Atlanta, sir, she answered. Georgia? I asked shockingly. Yes, sir. Right this way, she said. I blinked my eyes a couple of times, adjusting to the light. I soon realized I was standing in front of a five-story strip mall. A laundromat, a pizza place, a pet crematorium, a law firm, and a coffee shop. I need coffee, I said, and began to walk toward the coffee shop. We have free coffee, sir. Right this way, she stated, grabbed my arm, and led me through the door, around the desk, to the last door on the right. She knocked on the door, and said, cream and sugar. Right? Sir. I just looked at her funny. How does she know? I thought, but just said, yes, please. The door then opened. Ah. Mr. Thompson. It's so nice to finally meet you. Come on in. Have a seat, the older gray-haired gentleman said, as he sat behind his desk. I'm David, something Jewish. Before we get started, do you have any questions for me? He asked, placing a stack of papers on the desk. Yeah, I responded harshly, as I stretched, trying to wake up. How do you know my name? How did you get my address? Who delivered that letter? Was it you that called my job? Who the hell is Agnes Miller? And who is she to me? I said loudly. He smiled, and said, your name and address are in the will. How Agnes knew, I don't know. There are specific instructions noted within the will, which state that I am to personally place that letter in your mailbox for you to find. Which I did, and you did as well. Yes. It was me that called. I did some research on you and found out your employer's name, called them and told them you had a family emergency. Agnes Miller was a very old and very wealthy woman in our town. And to answer your last question, I have no idea, I'm just an attorney who's handling the will, he said, smiling. Stacy then returned, with a small styrofoam cup of coffee. "Here you go, sir," she said, handed me the cup, stepped back, and stood in the corner, with her hands cupped in front of her. "Thank you," I replied, and took a sip of the coffee. It was weak and watered down, but hey, weak coffee is better than no coffee. Right? Anyway, back to the story. "Now, Mr. Thompson, if you'll be so kind as to sign and date the last page of the following three documents, we can get you on your way to your new home," David said, and placed three stacks of papers in front of me. "The first is for the bank account, the second is for the home and property, and the third is for the vehicle," he stated, placing his hand on top of each one as he did. He then handed me a pen. I then flipped to the back page of each stack. I was reluctant to sign because I still wasn't sure this was legit, but I figured, take a chance, live a little, and signed my name on the dotted lines and dated them as well. "Very good, sir," he said. "I'll have the documents drawn up, with your name on them, and personally deliver them to you tomorrow. It was a pleasure meeting you. I hope you enjoy your new wealth and home. Stacy will drive you to your new property." He then extended his hand, and I shook it. "Are you ready, sir?" Stacy asked. "I guess so," I said in return. I grabbed the cup of coffee, waved bye to David as he picked up the phone. He waved back, and we left. As we were walking out, I heard David say, "Yes, I need to make arrangements for." "Arrangements for what?" I thought. Stacy and I then walked outside. I finished the coffee, and threw the cup in the trash, got in the limousine once again, and began driving down the road. I had no idea where I was going. It was really hard to see out of those tinted windows, but I think we passed a funeral home next to a grocery store, with a bank right across the street, and a hardware store just down the road, as well as a few houses and small businesses. After about 20 minutes of driving, we made a right-hand turn as Stacy announced over the intercom, "Welcome to your new home, sir," and stopped the car shortly after. Seconds later, she opened the door, I stepped out of the limousine, at the entrance to the property, and just stood there, in complete awe of what I saw. It was a huge piece of land, in the middle of nowhere, at least 50 acres wide, surrounded by a 10-foot black iron fence, with what looked like large football stadium light panels on top of large wooden poles, around the entire fence, about 50 feet away from each other, and pointed down at the trees. There were two dark gray pillars on either side of the driveway. On the left pillar was a plaque that simply read, "I want to be a tree." For some unknown strange reason, those words were familiar to me. Anyway, in the direct center of the property, straight up the driveway, sat a bright yellow and white, two-story, colonial-styled house, with a wraparound porch, something huge in front of it, and a small garage to the right of it. I could barely see it through the trees. Trees were covering practically the entire property. "All this is mine?" I asked Stacy. "Yes, sir," she replied. "Anyway, let me tell you about these trees. They were not all the same, no. Although there were several dogwood trees, crab apple trees, different varieties of oak trees, and pine trees, among many others. Some I had never seen before. Anyway, they were all different sizes, all mixed throughout the property. Which was very odd to me. Okay, it's some kind of tree farm, I can do that. I'll just Google how to take care of them," I thought. "Anyway, if you'd like to get in, I'll drive you up to the house, sir," Stacy said. "Please. Call me Richard," I responded. "Okay. Richard. Let me drive you to the house," she said. I got in, and she did. In front of the house was a huge stone water fountain, fully operational and cool as hell. The driveway circled it. Anyway, Stacy pulled up to the front door. This time, I let myself out. She got out, walked around the front of the limo, and handed me a set of keys. "Here you go, sir." Richard. She's all yours. Enjoy," she said. "What about my clothes and stuff?" I asked. She then walked back around the front of the limo and said, "David is in the process of taking care of that right now. It'll take a couple of days for your things to arrive. Nice to meet you. Bye." That must be what David is trying to arrange, I thought. She then got back in the limo, drove back down the driveway, made a left, then disappeared out of sight. I stood there, in complete awe. Is this for real? Is this stuff mine? I thought. David said that one of those stacks of papers were for a vehicle. I don't see any vehicle. Let's check the garage, I thought to myself. I walked over to the garage, found the key that looked like it fit, put it in the lock, and turned it. I felt the mechanism open. I lifted the garage door to find. Now brace yourself. I found a teal-colored 1957 Chevy, mint condition, just sitting there. If I remember correctly, I was so excited, I think I pissed myself a little. I fumbled around with the keys, unlocked the driver's side door, got in, and fired that mother up. Damn. Did she sound nice, purred like a kitten. With a full tank of gas, no less. Anyway, once I calmed down, I decided to go check out the house. I mean, after all, that was where I'd be living. If the house is as nice as the car, I'm never going back to Delaware, I thought. I turned the car off, got out, shut the door, walked out of the garage, pulled the door down, locked it, and walked to the house. I found the key, unlocked the door, and opened it. It was amazing and immaculately clean. I try my best to keep it that way. Anyway, as you walk in, you are immediately in the atrium. It's a huge open area, with dual staircases on either side of an elevator door. The staircases lead to a surrounding walkway, with a hallway leading to the back of the house, straight ahead, as soon as you get up the stairs, and several doors and paintings, along the walkway. Several large white pillars hold the walkway up from the first floor to the second floor. There is a giant-sized painting of the Last Supper, on the wall to your right, and a giant-sized painting of the property, before all the trees, on the wall to your left. Below each painting is a door, leading to other rooms in the house. Anyway, I spent the rest of the day, and into the night, checking out the house. It's a huge house. Anyway, it consisted of 5 bedrooms, fully furnished. A huge kitchen, fully stocked. A parlor and a living area, both fully furnished. 3 full bathrooms, fully operational. A study, fully furnished. An indoor swimming pool, fully operational. And a laundry room, fully operational as well. The elevator was key entry only. I didn't have that key, which was odd. I tried everyone, with no luck. Anyway, afterward, I got something to eat, I don't remember what it was. I sat down on the couch, turned on the TV, found the remote, flipped through the channels, and found some rerun marathon of Chicago PD. I must have fallen asleep because I had the strangest dream. I was walking through the trees at night as the fog slowly covered the land. The full moon shining down. I began to hear dogs barking viciously, cats hissing wildly, as well as the painful moans of men, women, and children. I started looking around and saw nothing that would have made those sounds. The air suddenly got cold, as the wind picked up drastically. I then felt a hand grab my shoulder. I turned around to see this old woman, in a dingy gray dress floating in the air. Her face was wrinkled, black holes where her eyes should have been. I screamed in fear, stepped back, lost my balance, and fell to the ground, as she leaned over the top of me. Her face was mere inches from mine. I could smell her hot, wretched breath. She turned her head to the left and said 5 words. They roamed in the darkness. Then flew up quickly, like she was being sucked up into the sky. I got up quickly and began running for the house, but getting nowhere. It was like I was running on a treadmill. Suddenly, all the lights on the poles came on, blinding me. I was then startled awake by the sound of the doorbell ringing repeatedly. I got up and staggered to the front door, opened it, to see David standing there. "Good morning, Richard. I have those papers for you," he said. "Come on in," I mumbled. "Do you want some coffee?" As I walked to the kitchen, set up the coffee pot, turned it on, and sat down at the dining room table. David joined me soon after. "Here is the deed to your home and property. Here is the title to your car, and here are the papers for the bank. You'll need to take these with you to the bank, show them to the bank manager, at which time the account will be changed over into your name," he said. The coffee pot then beeped. "How do you take your coffee?" I asked him. Black was his response. I reached in the cabinet, pulled out two coffee cups, poured mine, added the cream and sugar, handed David his, sat mine on the table, and stood there. Can I ask you something? I asked. Sure, he answered. Do you know anything about this Agnes Miller person, or anything about this property? I asked. Not really, only what I told you at the office. And I don't know anything about this property. It's nice though, he said, why do you ask? I had a really strange dream last night, I answered. Dreams have a way of coming true, you know, he stated. That's what I'm afraid of, I responded. He finished his coffee, put the cup on the table, and said, well, I've got to get going, thanks for the coffee, I'll see myself out. Have a good day, Richard. You as well, I replied. He then left. I sat at the table, drinking my coffee, looking at the papers for the bank. Hell, I'm not doing anything today, let's see how much money I've got, I said to myself. I made a cup of coffee to go, grabbed the papers off the table, went out to the garage, hopped in the car, put the address of the bank into Google Maps, and drove there. I walked in and asked the girl behind the desk if I could speak to the bank manager. She said, sure. Have a seat. I sat down, and a few minutes later, an older gentleman walked out of one of the offices, walked up to me, and introduced himself. You must be Mr. Thompson. Hi. I'm Bill, the bank manager. David said you'd be stopping by. Right this way, please, sir, he said. I got up and followed him. We walked into the office, he sat behind the desk, I sat in the chair in front of it and handed him the papers. He hit a couple of keys on the keyboard, asked me to sign some documents, handed me a bank registry, a debit card, and a box full of checks, then turned the monitor around, so I could see the screen and said, there you go, Mr. Thompson. It's all yours now, and pointed to the lower right corner of the screen. I looked where he was pointing and almost shit myself, literally. The balance in the account was $1,684,297.58. I fought like hell to maintain my composure, as I simply said, thank you, shook Bill's hand, walked out of the office, out of the bank, got in the car, and drove home. I got out of the car, and with no one around, I did the biggest happy dance I ever did in my life. Anyway, I called my boss, and quit right there on the spot. I don't have to work anymore, I thought. I called my landlord, back in Delaware, and told him I was moving out. He wasn't too happy, but I had over a million reasons not to care. Anyway, since it was a beautiful day outside, I decided to take a walk around the property and check out the trees. I started on the left side of the house. As I walked along, I noticed that every tree I passed had a nameplate. Agnes must have named the trees, for some reason, I thought. Names like William, Scott, Tiffany, and Barbara, almost every name in the book, with a lot of duplicates. That's odd, I thought, why would you have several trees with the same name, even one with your name? Anyway, I walked the entire left side, then began on the right. Those trees also had nameplates, but they were odd names. Names like Diamond, Coco, Peanut, and Zeus, among many others. Again with many duplicates. Those must be nicknames, I thought. Anyway, after my venture around the property, which took about 3 hours, I decided to relax and go for a swim. I didn't have a swimsuit, so I decided to swim in my birthday suit, you know, naked. Anyway, I swam around for longer than I thought because when I got out, it was dark outside. Anyway, I dried off, put a towel that was hanging on the wall around my waist, grabbed my clothes and proceeded to walk up to the room I decided to make my bedroom, which was at the top of the stairs, the last door on your left. I was pretty relaxed after that long swim. I decided to just go to bed. My clothes and stuff should be here in the morning, I thought, I'll just sleep naked. After all, I'd been in the same clothes for 2 days. Anyway, as you all know, I was there alone, by myself, with no one else in the house. Right? That's what I thought. Well, as I left the pool area, walked down the hallway, into the atrium, and began to walk up the stairs, I heard a dog bark, then another, just like in the dream. but I was awake. It sounded like it was coming from outside. So, I quickly walked to the front door, opened it, and stood there in nothing but a towel, looking around. In the dim moonlight, I could barely see anything. The barking got louder and more intense. I shut and locked the door, blew it off as stray dogs, shut off all the lights, then proceeded up the stairs. I got to my bedroom, opened the door, and was hit directly in the face by a freezing burst of air. I began to hear cats hissing, as the dogs barked on. Suddenly, I heard the front doorbell ring. I walked back down the stairs, still in my towel. "Delivery for Thompson." "Delivery," I heard a young man say. "I'm coming," I yelled, turned on the atrium light, as well as the outside light, unlocked the door, and opened it. I saw a young man, maybe in his mid-20s, standing there, with five boxes, marked clothes, stacked on a dolly. I leaned out the door and screamed, "Shut up," trying to get the dogs and cats to stop. "Are you okay, sir?" the young man said, and looked at me funny. I stood there confused. "You don't hear that?" I asked.
"Hear what, sir?"
he asked.
"The dogs and cats," I said.
"No, sir," he replied, shaking his head. "Please sign here," then handed me a clipboard. I signed on the dotted line and handed it back to him. "Put it right there," I said and pointed just inside the door. He did, turned around, and left. I shut the door and locked it again. Still, the dogs barked and the cats hissed. "Am I going crazy?" I asked myself, as I carried each box upstairs and into my bedroom. They were quite heavy. "Anyway, what the hell is going on?" I said to myself, "Am I the only one that can hear this?" After my last trip carrying the boxes, I turned the lights out and couldn't take the noises any longer. It felt like my head was going to explode. I got up to my bedroom, jumped in bed, pulled the covers up over my head, put the pillow over my head as well, to try and drown out the noise. It didn't work. The noises kept getting louder and louder. Soon, I began to hear the moans of the men, women, and children, along with horses neighing and pigs squealing. I quickly got up and ran to the top of the stairs, still naked, mind you. I looked out into the atrium and saw my front door wide open. The moonlight shining through the opening, that's how I knew. "I know I locked that door," I thought. I ran down the stairs and attempted to shut the door, but it wouldn't move. "What the fuck?
Close.
Damn it. Close," I shouted, as I struggled with the door. Another cold burst of air, then another, then another. The moaning grew louder, almost to a deafening pitch. The barking grew vicious, the hissing grew violent. "Fuck this shit. Fuck this house. I'm keeping the money, and the car. But I ain't staying in some haunted ass house. I'm out of here," I said to myself, as I ran out the front door and to the garage. "Fuck," I screamed, turning the handle and realizing I locked it.
"The keys.
Where are the keys?" I screamed, as I began to pat my thighs, where my pockets would be. Amidst all the chaos, I forgot I was naked. "Son of a bitch," I screamed. I turned to run back into the house. Somehow, the moon appeared to be full now. That's when I saw what looked to be a pack of wild dogs charging straight at me, straight up the driveway. I could see right through them. I turned to my right, toward the house, and began to see multiple transparent images of men, women, and children appear right in front of me, beside me, and behind me. Horses and pigs as well, off in the distance. I screamed in fear. "If I'm going down, I'm going down swinging," I told myself and began to run through them, screaming like a wild man. As I did, the ones I hit turned to dust and blew away in the wind. Swarms of ferocious, hissing cats began to fall from several of the trees, landing on all fours, and looking right at me. I finally made it to the front door and ran inside. I then ran as fast as I could, up the stairs, and into my bedroom. I raced into the room to get my pants off the floor and retrieve my keys. In my frantic state, I tripped over the boxes and slammed hard into the side of the dresser, causing it to fall over and the mirror on top as well. Luckily, the mirror didn't break. Anyway, I looked down at the dresser, for some reason, and found a large manila envelope taped to the back of it, with the words, "Richard Thompson."
"Play me," written on it. I quickly ripped it from the dresser and opened it. Inside, I found an unmarked DVD and a strange-looking key. "What the hell is this?" I thought to myself. I quickly ran out of the bedroom, down the stairs, and to the living area, with the disc and key. I hit the open button on the DVD player, put the disc in, then closed it and turned the TV on. The moaning and animal noises continued. I then pressed play. Suddenly, an old frail woman appeared on the screen, wearing a gray dress. She said, "Hello, Richard. I bet you're wondering who I am, and why I left everything to you. Well, my name is Agnes Miller. If you're watching this, I'm dead. I decided to leave everything to you, because, after all, it was your idea. You see, your grandmother and I were sisters. She married a man named Thompson, which is where your last name comes from. I never married, so I kept the last name of Miller. You never knew about me, because your grandmother and I had a rather nasty argument when you were just a small child, which resulted in us never speaking to each other ever again. I remember seeing you at her funeral years later. She died way too young. That's what smoking cigarettes will do to you. Anyway, you were standing with your mother and your father. You were so handsome, so brave. I heard you tell her that when you die, you want to come back as a tree. I want to be a tree," were your exact words. Your statement stuck with me. I thought it was a great idea. Now, with such a big piece of property, I had many animals, dogs, cats, pigs, chickens, among many others. When they died, I had them cremated, at the crematorium in town, dug a hole, poured their ashes in the ground, and planted a tree on top of them. I told all my friends what I had done. They also thought it was a great idea, and wished to have the same thing done to them when they died. Given the fact that they were my friends, I agreed to let their ashes be buried on my property, marked by a tree of their choosing. As time went on, word got around the town of what I was doing, and people would bring their pets' ashes and their loved ones' ashes to me, and for a small price, I would allow the ashes of their pets and loved ones to be buried on the property as well. They would provide the tree, I would just maintain it. I made a small fortune doing it, all under the table, of course. Visitation was available by appointment only. I didn't want strangers roaming around my yard. Now, all was going well, until one night many years ago, the spirits of the animals and people suddenly began to roam freely in the darkness, making such a ruckus that it was quite intolerable. But remained quiet throughout the day. This went on for several nights. I had the light panels installed shortly after, so it would duplicate sunlight at night and trick the spirits into believing it's daytime. It works, for the most part. Occasionally, you'll hear a pig squeal or a voice in the wind, nothing too out of control. So, please, for your sanity, turn on those lights before nightfall, or things will not go well for you. Too late, I thought. She continued by saying, "You should have found a key. With this recording, use the key to activate the elevator, go down to the basement. There, you will find 5 industrial power switches, flip the switches to the on position, and you should be all right. You must do this before nightfall. I hope you enjoy your new home and fortune. I only hope you will continue what I have started. Thank you for your time. Goodbye." The screen then went black. I just sat there, trying to comprehend what I just heard. It's not a tree farm, it's a cemetery, and the trees mark each grave. The nameplates aren't the names of the trees, they're the names of the people and the animals buried underneath of them. This is cool as hell, I thought, but I can't deal with the spirits. I grabbed the key and ran to the elevator, still naked, put the key in the hole and it fit. I turned it, and the door opened. I got in, hit the down button, and the door closed. The elevator then began to go down. Shortly after, it stopped, and the doors opened. Now, what she called a basement, was a 10 by 10 room, with power units mounted to the wall. I pushed every handle up into the on position, got back in the elevator, and hit the up button. The doors closed, and the elevator began to rise. Soon after, it stopped, and the doors opened. I walked out into the atrium, then out the front door. The stadium lights were shining bright, and all was peaceful and calm. No more dogs barking, no cats hissing, no creepy transparent ghost people,
Nothing. Just peace and quiet. I stood there, on the front porch, completely naked, and smiling, for about 20 minutes. I finally said, "Rest in peace, everyone," walked back into the house, shut and locked the door, walked up the stairs to my bedroom, closed the curtains to block the lights, crawled into bed, and had the most peaceful sleep that I had in a long, long time. I woke up the next morning, got dressed, got some coffee, turned off the lights, walked outside, and said, "Rest in peace, everyone." Once again. I always say that to them, every morning, and every night, out of respect. Anyway, I then decided if I was going to do this, I was going to do it big. I called David and asked him to help me obtain a business license, and maybe put me in touch with an advertising company. He did, and now I Want to Be a Tree is a legitimate business. I spent thousands of dollars on advertising, you know, ads on the newspaper, 30-second radio spots, and a few commercials, things like that. Business is going great. People even send their loved ones to me in the mail, through UPS and FedEx, from all around the world, with a check and a description of the kind of tree they want over the grave. I'm thinking of branching out in different states, I don't know, we'll see. Anyway, I open the property up for visitation from 7 a.m. to 10 p.m. every day, including weekends and holidays. There are always people around, and the property is filled with beautiful wreaths and pretty flowers, at least till they die. I made a few friends. I hired a landscaping team to take care of the property and the trees. I turn the lights on at 6 p.m. every night, whether it's dark or not, then turn them back off at 8 a.m. just to be sure. I haven't had any problems with the spirits so far, and don't plan to. So, if you want to be a tree when you die, give us a call at 1-800-I'm-A-Tree and ask for Richard. I'll be waiting for your call.